All right, good evening and welcome to our 34th meeting of the Jacksonville Environmental and Appearance Advisory Committee. All of you have had the agenda was emailed out earlier, and if not, I'm sure you've had time to look over it tonight while you've been here. Do we have a motion to adopt or amend?
I make a motion.
Thank you.
I say.
All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
All right, the agenda is as written. The minutes from the February 2nd meeting, those were also emailed out. So I'm sure everybody's had a chance to look over those as well. So do we have a motion to adopt or correct or even reject
the minutes? A motion to adopt.
Second.
Thank you. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Very well. The minutes will be adopted as written. Tonight, we have Jason Smith, who will be doing a presentation for us. So it's all yours, Jason.
Well, thank you, and thank y'all for being here. Thank you for allowing me to come. Should be a eye opener for some that are here, and hopefully you are proud of what we do and how we do it, because I am.
Yeah, you've done a great job.
As you've seen here, we are doing annual flowers. This is a typical signature of what we are trying to do more of from year to year. As we do more, we add more. And this is one of the mum beds, some of the violas that we typically do. Typically, we're doing summer annuals and winter annuals. Our summer annuals are typically in the summertime, obviously May and June is when we install, and then in the fall, September, October timeframe. Right now, this past year, we added extra beds, Riverwalk Park, the splash pad area, and we added the flower pots out front on the Johnson side of City Hall. And this is a project we did right at the end of when we did a presentation last year. This is one where, obviously, everybody knows the landing. You can see where we had a lot of erosion problems going forward, and it just was a lot of maintenance for us to take care of. It was tough on the guys mowing it, so this is what we did to make it look a little bit, you know, more presentable and help with some of the erosion going long term. We installed roughly 120 pallets of zoysia grass, and this project took close to 3 weeks to complete. Obviously, everybody knows about the splash pad, but this is what the actual splash pad looked like during construction. This is kind of what we inherited once the actual pad itself and everything, the components were put together. And this is why we were laying sod. We were getting it to where you're going to see in just a second what it looks like today. We ended up putting roughly 1,200 square feet of pavers. We done all this internally with our manpower. We put in roughly three trees up on the front section for a shade for long-term purposes with the picnic tables, and then you see the annual flowers that we put around and smaller shrubbery. If you look in the background of this picture, you'll actually see where we did Arbor Day last year, right in that general area right in there. So we incorporated what we already were doing to add to what we have here. This is at Public Services, and in the very back of Public Services. I'm not sure if you've been to that complex or not, but it's in the very back. We had a lot of erosion problems. This was something that was been a long-term problem for years. And of course, we have to maintain this area, and it just was not beneficial. It wasn't, you know, cost-effective from a manpower standpoint. We were having to manually weed-eat around this whole area. So what we've done is we went back in, regraded, fixed in holes, fixed the elevations in some areas, and made it a whole lot easier from a maintenance perspective. This and that project took roughly about a week, so it was a quick turnaround on that project. But from our seat, from a Parks Department, from that standpoint, it's very efficient. Obviously, this is the amphitheater. A lot of you have heard about the amphitheater. It is still in construction phase. You can see where the contractors had put in wheat straw, and basically in the center of the picture to the right, you can see the rows of sod, and basically it's like a stair step. This is where the seating area is going to be. And this is what we ended up having to do. We actually took rolls of sod and just rolled them down the hill. I mean, in reality, that's what we ended up doing. But this is basically for soil stabilization for construction. We didn't want it to move. Currently, Scott Perosi, our assistant park superintendent, he's been on this project for about close to a month now when everything's said and done. And he's actually putting in a block wall as the seating area. So next year, hopefully, you see pictures, you know, of a finished product or close to being finished product, and we're having some concerts or whatever else going out there. New Bridge Street, this is right across the street. This was an area that was a sight for my eyes when I first got here, because, you know, it is a city parking lot, and you know, we've revitalized a lot of downtown areas, and we felt like this was one of my on my list that we needed to do something a little bit better. You know, we have city vehicles parked here. We want the public to see something that represents the city of Jacksonville. So obviously you see the stages here. We went back and took out a lot of plant material that just weren't doing well. We you know, areas where we had grass or weeds, and basically revamped that whole area into something a little bit more fresh. This was a North Carolina DOT funded project. The city didn't pay for other than the labor part. The material, the plants, the rock, all that was paid through DOT funding. We are getting ready, and you'll see going forward, they started groundbreaking for the other parking lot across on the other side of the accounting building. Construction started on that today, I think it was. Mm-hmm. In approximately 2 weeks, we will get that given to us. We will go in and put landscaping in that general area. It's right up against Stratford, if you don't know where that's at. New Bridge Street, if you walk across the street, you'll see this. This was a Dr. Woodruff idea. We wanted to do something just to see what, you know, as a little prototype area, if you want to say. This was all done with city staff. It was a joint effort from engineering to planning to streets, actually doing the concrete work, to utilities, making sure that the lines were safe for us to do the excavation, to what we did to it. And it does give that area a little bit of a touch.
Mm-hmm. I got to jump in for a minute, if we can go back real quick to that picture. And I got to tell you, that's $5,000 right there, because we were able to do this internally with the city. That's a big deal. City did the concrete work. We used engineering to help with the designs. The park staff put it in, yada, yada, yada. But we got a great bang for our buck. So when you hear Dr. Woodruff talk about some of the bulb outs, and I know you've heard that term, this is the first pilot of the bulb outs.
And the job, from my perspective, it only took us a day and a half to do what we had to do.
Oh, wow.
So, yes, there was a lot of planning involved, mm-hmm. but in reality, the bang for your buck was very minimal, and the time staff actually had to go out there and do it, you know, and we were able to use brick chips, which are long-term, which is a whole lot more efficient. We're not having to worry about people being out in the streets, having to replenish mulch, you know, et cetera. And obviously everybody knows about the parkway, Huff Drive, the interchange. These are obviously the pictures of the beginning stages of after it was installed. This is what Huff Drive looked like to begin with. And this is what it looks like now. The one interesting thing was, you know, this was a 2-year project as far as the design to get complete when everything's said and done. But we did it to make it a lot more easier for us to mow. If you look at the angles of how the beds were, that type of thing, It makes us still efficient. We don't have to weed eat any of that. We can go around it with our mowers and continue going like we were before when we didn't have landscaping in those islands. And that's the interchange. This was a federally funded job through DOT. It didn't cost the city any money far as that part goes for the materials or contracting out. The city did oversee the project. It consisted of a 90-day window for installation, which was a quick turnaround. And the project cost approximately $350,000. There was 211 trees, 3,454 shrubs, 6,606 perennial and grasses, 1,456 cubic yards of topsoil, and over 1,000 cubic yards of chocolate mulch. I know that I did approximately like 6 inspections on this job. It was a very quick turnaround, but trying to count that many plants, you know, in a short window, you know, it's time consuming. The warranty for the contractor for the plant material ends in September. We have an inspection coming up in May to go back over some of the plant material. I've already inspected some of the areas already. And it actually is giving us approximately 3 acres of landscaping beds when the project will be handed back to us. One caveat to that is actually we will be maintaining this starting as of Monday. So you're going to see it cleaned up a little bit more than what it is currently right now, okay? Which is, it's a big job. Clean and green, this is who we are. You know, this is the things that you know, not necessarily want to be doing, but it's things that we do and we are good with it. Mm-hmm. This is before and after. This is just a small look of, you know, it's every day. This is our every day when we get out to the roadways.
We appreciate that. Yes.
Mm-hmm. We were able to buy some equipment here. These are vent tracks. And on these equipment, you know, they've actually got a piece where it's actually an edging disc. It's made our job a little bit more efficient and a little bit easier for being able to edge a lot of these areas that maybe we don't do on a regular basis a whole lot faster. But with edging, streets gets involved, the police department gets involved, so it's a joint effort from several different city departments for us to be able to do these.
I want to bring up the edging component. We've talked about this, you know. We've been edging some of the streets within the city for a couple of years now, and it takes us a long time because in the past we've always done this. It's labor driven. And we were able to do Gum Branch Road this year. Mm-hmm. And how much time did that take us?
Maybe. Well, 17 was the big one that really saved us. You know, 17, we did it in a day and a half. And we're talking weeks.
Yeah. I mean, we saved weeks there. And so, again, trying to stay with the 3 E's and being efficient and what we do and how we're doing things costs a little money up front, again, but your bang for the buck is through time.
We were able to purchase this. This was kind of Dr. Woodruff's idea to begin with. And it doesn't look like much, but it packs a good little punch. We use it for several different things as we've purchased it. We bought it originally to suck up cigarette butts at intersections. If you ever sit at a stoplight, you will understand why we tried to find something that we could make it a little bit easier, you know, instead of individually picking them up. And what we found out is we were able to use this at the commons around the boundary fences with the leaves during the fall. So we've been able to use this in several different applications as we've gotten into it and figured out, you know, what it can and can't do for us. We pick up roughly 70 pounds of trash a day. Last year, we were around 50 pounds. So I know that doesn't sound like a lot, but that's every single day. It equals 16,000 pounds a year. Cigarette butts, the edging, we're continuing to try to improve, to try to do more. As, you know, we have the time, we find the time to do more, buying pieces of equipment that makes us a little bit more efficient, the more we can do that you can see. And obviously Christmas decorations, this was a big, big deal for us this year, I think. You know, we typically do the Christmas tree in the you know, the winter. We do the banners. But the Christmas tree this year, we put 10,000 lights on the Christmas tree this year. It was the first time we did it. We actually were blowing the the fuse, if you want to say. And we put a little twinkle to it, which made it a little bit more interesting. And then in the back end of Christmas, we put in some Christmas presents around the tree to kind of give it a little bit more that lit up. And you haven't seen anything yet. We're getting ready to, this coming year, we're going to make it a little bit better.
Great.
So, you know, we've added, you know, we're doing 120, you know, banners throughout the year. We do 245 Christmas decorations during Christmas, not including the tree. And we've added the presents, but we're also looking at doing some interesting things in the park itself, trying to decorate a little bit more red, white, and blue. So hopefully in the future you're going to see something a little bit different. In the Commons, I know we had talked a little bit earlier, we're doing some enhancements at the Commons. If you haven't seen some of them, please ride by, take a look. I think you're going to be a little happier. This is around a ball field. This is kind of a prototype area. You know, we're looking to try to bring more attention to the scoreboard, make it a little bit more beautiful as far as roses and that type of thing to give it some more color. Plus, we're putting a little bit more color into the trees, making it more evergreen, not necessarily all dormant trees in the wintertime. We installed 20 trees around one ball field, 15 shrubs around the scoreboard. It is a prototype for the rest of the Commons ball fields, and it took literally only 3 days to do it. So it's a quick bang for your buck when it comes down to it. And then Richard Ray Park. This has been our project for probably 5 or 6 weeks whenever we started. This is the new concept plan to your right. This is how it was set up originally. We expanded the landscape beds in this. We took basically stuff from scratch. We added beds around the curbing. We were having some issues with people driving in. We wanted to kind of make it a little bit more more eye appealing, so maybe you don't do that. We put some knockout roses, red, pink, red, and yellow knockout roses in those entryways and exits. And then we took all these beds and refurbished the first four regions of the park. We expanded the beds. Not only did we do that, we added plant material. They are geographically regioned plant material as well. And we made it a lot easier from a maintenance standpoint, putting fabric, that, et cetera, from weed controls and that type of thing. But you can see on the left what it looks like on the right-hand side. And yes, we removed some trees, but we also installed some smaller trees back in its place. This is a 2-year project. This, we did the first 4 out of 7. We have 3 more left. We will do the next ones next year. We have new signage going out into those beds. What you saw, that new sign, you'll see it in each region. It'll have some explanations of some of the plant material that's already in there. Ultimately, one day, I wanted to make it a little bit more arboretum style, where if we have a lot of residents that come from out of state, hopefully they can come to their region and see plant material that they're used to. That's the ultimate, you know, goal. And here's the Commons administration. We did a facelift here. And, you know, we did the annual flowers already, but we wanted to do something to the actual plant beds themselves. This is in front of the seniors building. And this is the parking lot area that we transformed. Yes. and we put 25 trees, 100 shrubs, 75 perennials, a bunch of aluminum edging, and some brick chips. And it took around 3 weeks to get it accomplished. We currently, you know, obviously we do a lot of DOT mowing, and we have a newer contract with DOT that was signed last year. This is the piece of equipment down at the bottom. You can see it. That's the vent track, the one I told you with the edger attachment. It also is a mower for us. But if you see this ditch on the left-hand side, this is pretty much a typical DOT area on roadways. This was one of the newer areas that we picked up in our contract. And we did 90% of the work with that machine. And that ditch was full of water when we were doing it. It is a tremendous help and asset to our department to be more efficient and to cut down on the manual labor when it comes down to it. You know, and we really, you know, we done this probably 3 weeks ago. So a lot of you probably are wondering what we've been doing at the Grove. And I can tell you we've done a lot at the Grove, and we continue to do a lot. We're doing sulfur applications. We have removed the tree stakes. They are sturdy. They are in the ground. I don't think we got any loss today, obviously, with the wind that we had. we've been doing mulch around the tree rings. We have repaired some washout areas that we've ran into up on the sides of the hill. If you see the erosion matting as you go by on 17, you'll see that. And, you know, we pick up trash. Our clean and green guys, they pick up trash there weekly. We have currently, as of today, only lost two trees. We had those have been replaced, and we only have lost one knockout rose out of 650. We're getting ready to do another weed application, and then we're going to do some turf fertilizer. We mow it typically every 2 to 3 weeks during the growing season. Obviously, right now, we're just now getting into the growing season, so we do it as needed right now during this time of the year. And we had one incident with our irrigation. We completely lost contact to our pump that was down in the bottom of the well. Luckily, FMS, our facility maintenance, and utilities helped us out in retrieving it, actually going down, hooking back up to it, shimmying it up, fixing it, rewiring it, and putting it back down. And that actually saved us because we had to get it quoted. We were going to have to put a new system in. It probably saved us close to $10,000 when it was said and done. So that was a tremendous work between departments that really, I mean, from a budgetary standpoint, saved us a lot. Here's some of the irrigation repairs that we've had to make. That's the actual pump in the well that I was talking about. That thing is actually right at 80 pounds. It's a lot heavier than what it looks. It was down 160 feet in the ground. And this is Mr. LaCorey mowing grass with the vent track. When we first got it, we started mowing on the hill. And yes, he does work. And this is a sulfur application. You know, that we have to do this every year because of the pH. We have to keep a pH to a certain level, and this is the sulfur that does that.
I want to talk real quick about this mower right here. And where you see we're at here is on what I call, it's the 17th side of the Grove. So as you're coming back into town and you're looking to your right, this is the 17th side. Again, the value of this piece of equipment for us. In the past, we were weed eating that slope. Wow. That's a lot of manpower, a lot of time. It's got to be done. That mower right there, we're able to mow that slope with this mower. So again, trying to be efficient in what we're doing. And you know, we spent a couple of minutes with you tonight, and we have shown you three things that have created a lot, three very different things that have created a lot of efficiencies for us, so we're able to do more with what we already had. So just wanted to point that out to you.
So the work that we've done on the slides that we showed you, we've installed over 150 trees this past year, 245 decorations, 120 banners, 3,500 seasonal annuals, 100 tons of brick chips, 900 shrubs, 300 bales of pine straw, 500 yards of mulch, 150 pallets of sod, and an estimated work amount of $300,000. If you correlate that with the DOT money, we're talking $650. And, you know, I'm thankful that we're able to either get funding or have funding to be able to do these types of things. I don't like wasting money. I want to make sure we do it one time. We're trying to be as efficient as we can, but we'd rather touch it once than have to come back. Our upcoming projects, we are currently right now working on the Riverwalk Pod 2 sod project. If you go out there right now, it looks like a pool based off of how much rain we've had. We are going to be maintaining Huff Drive Parkway and Highway 17 interchange. We're going to do the next three beds at Riverwalk or at Richard Ray Park. And then we are going to be looking at doing some different beds down New Bridge Street here in the near future. Hopefully we'll be finishing the amphitheater. We still have some landscaping to do. We still have some block work to do and some steps and stuff like that we still have to take care of. And then we have a project over at Public Services. We're trying to cut down on maybe some efficiencies over there of trying to make it a little bit easier for us to maintain it on a weekly basis by doing some landscaping around that area. We're going to do more ball fields over at the Commons, and we're going to be hopefully doing the landscaping at the cemetery. If you look on the corner of Johnson, you'll see they're getting ready to put in a sign. Obviously, we're going to be addressing that up just a tad bit more than what we had before. And hopefully when we get the new gateway signs, we'll be doing landscaping around the new gateway signs once those are installed. In the near future, we'll oversee, just like we oversaw the project for DOT, overseeing the Sturgeon City installation of the Environmental Education Center with the landscaping project there. And we're doing the Stratford Road. That will be within the next 3 weeks, the parking lot over here. And we will start maintaining the rails to trail by the Memorial Gardens. We've already done a little bit of work over there. We've done some thinning out, and we've done one type of mowing there, but it's going to be something where we're going to have to maintain, you know, just like we do now on the rails to trails on a weekly basis. And, you know, this is stuff that's a little bit new, the Western Boulevard landscaping. I can tell you that I do have drawings for Western Boulevard, for certain islands on Western Boulevard. We are waiting for funding. Hopefully in the near future, we'll see some of that funding. And we've also found out that there's some possible funding for the Piney Green gateway area / going into 24 to Country Club in that area, at possibly looking at some landscaping projects in that area from a DOT funding standpoint. Does anybody have any questions?
You're busy. And I ride around and it really looks good.
Thank you.
I just want to commend your department, because I see them down Western Boulevard picking up trash. I mean, it makes such a difference. I mean, it's so nice to ride down and see nice green with nice and clean.
Thank you.
Yes.
I really liked your photo op.
I had to put that in there.
That kind of got snuck in there, actually. Jason has done this, but there's one more thing we need to run through with you, and that is
mulching.
So we wanted to take you through some pointers about some mulching ideas that we have. Excuse me. And Suzanne, if you want to move to the next topic, we can. I'll just make sure Alan can bring it up for us, and we'll take it up in just a minute.
Are you sure?
Yeah.
Okay. All right, our next item is the subcommittee matters. So, Linda, do you have anything to share with the planning subcommittee?
Okay. Planning subcommittee, we met March 2nd. We talked about our citywide cleanup, which is in this month. We are focusing on large visible items and the large appliances. If everyone would call into the city on Wednesday and have the items, tell them you can't do but two, and have them sitting out by 7:30 Thursday, and they will pick up your large items. The city will.
Okay.
We talked about livable neighborhoods. There was an update that they're looking at Northwoods, Myrtlewood, Pickettown, and Market Street, the Livable Neighborhoods Committee. We also talked about adopt a program, and we had a priority list of the areas that we wanted to see if we could get some candidates to adopt. That was Center Street, Lakewood Drive, Williamsburg Parkway, New Frontier Way, Sandy Drive, Carolina Forest Boulevard, University Drive, Georgetown Road, River Street Parkside, Linwood Drive, East Thompson Street, and Ellis Boulevard. And some of the members did pick up. They were going to contact some people on the streets in that area that they knew to see if they would adopt one of those.
Oh, okay.
And the last thing we talked about was hazardous waste, and we passed out the tip sheets again, and I have some if anyone needs one. But it tells you what how to dispose of them when they're picked up and what to do to keep them. And it has a lot of key points that some members were not aware of. We're going to also do a project, and it was supposed to start tonight, but we are probably going to start next month. Each member is going to take a hazardous waste, and we're going to discuss it so that the city will know what we're talking about and what they can do with waste.
Oh, okay.
And our next meeting will be May 4th. That was it.
Perfect. Thank you. Patrick, you're next with the recognition.
I really don't have anything because I wasn't here for the last meeting, so I don't understand these comments that are on here, so I can't tell you much. It says that it was proposed that the selections agreed by the full committee were advanced to the April 18th City Council meeting, but I wasn't here, so I...
I think that was for the Christmas. I think maybe we voted on the Christmas.
I wasn't here, so I have no idea what the comments mean.
Okay.
I'm lost.
Next is the tree board, which that's myself. Arbor Day is going to be held on base this year. It's going to be Friday, April 21st at 9:30 a.m. And if any members, not just tree board, but any of us want to go, if before you leave tonight, if you'll fill this sheet out here, that way you can get access if you don't already have access to get on base. On February 21st, we met with the state forester about ideas and ways that we can expand our Tree City USA. You guys were both there. Do you want to share on some of those things?
Well, our PowerPoint is kind of going to cover some of that tonight.
Yes. Perfect.
They wanted us to do a little better job in the
education
from the educational side. Mm-hmm. So we had a very short PowerPoint presentation, and Alan should be bringing up any minute, and we'll take you through that. But until that comes up.
No, that's fine.
Here
we're
go.
We're going to it right now. So.
Thank you for making that happen.
Yeah. Not a problem.
This is more informational for viewers and for y'all to take home with you. I call it mulching the right way. Everybody has their own opinions on some things, but this is where my viewpoints come in from a city perspective and what we do. The benefits of mulching: it moderates soil temperatures, reduces soil moisture, it reduces soil compaction, it provides nutrients, improves soil structure, and it keeps mowers and string trimmers away from the trunk, promotes more root growth and healthier plant. These are good. The good mulching materials would be wood chips, bark nugget, composted leaves, pine needles. Some of your not so good materials: your sawdust, grass clippings, redwood or walnut mulch. Main thing with the grass clippings, typically you can have some diseases and fungus in your grass clippings. You don't want to put that around trees, okay? Your redwood and walnut mulches, termite, the redwoods, typically termites go that way. So you want to keep them away from it. Applying mulch to trees, drip line of trunk, I put it in a diagram to actually show what is typically called a drip line. It's basically your outer leaf canopy. And if that's not possible, if you've got a tree that's 50, 60 foot wide and that's just not, your yard's only 40, the good way of looking at it is, for a small tree is 3 foot, 8 foot for a medium tree, or 12 foot for the large trees. And that's radius. That's not diameter. That's radius, okay? If you look at the grove we have right now, roughly about a 4 foot radius. And I did that to know that these trees get to a certain size, and I want to go ahead and accommodate for some of that already. Applying mulch correctly, you need to do this directly to the soil surface. I've seen people use newspaper. I've seen people use paper, just regular paper. I've seen them, obviously you've seen the landscape fabrics and that type of thing. But for your best results, the organic matter between mulch and the ground is your best bet. It breaks down a whole lot quicker for nutrients for your tree. The mulch layer, 2 to 4 inches in depth, it varies. It also depends on the grade of your yard, if it's on a slope or it's flat, that type of thing. Applying correctly, do not mulch up against the tree trunk. I know a lot of people, they're like, what? But basically it retains moisture on the tree trunk itself. If you pull it back just a little bit, it's not that noticeable if you're just riding by, or it's not something where you're going to pay attention to it too much. Because what happens, the moisture gets on the trunk, it can cause diseases. And don't use the landscape fabric to separate the mulch from the soil, which is what I said. Yes, from a weed control standpoint, it might help you, but from a root system standpoint, not so much. And that's all I got.
That's good.
All right. You're up.
Sure.
So I just want to be educated. So if you can't use newspaper or fabric and you want to control the weeds, you don't want to put down weed killer over your roots, probably.
Correct.
Because that's bad for the tree. So what's the solution?
Hand pull. You could always hand pull. You could hand pull, but, you know, this is perfect case scenario. You know, not, this is not for everybody. Not everybody is going to do it one way or the other. I can tell you from a city's perspective, we've done it several different ways. You know, when we talk about the Grove, we have the manpower. We stay on it on a normal basis. And, yes, we do spray Roundup, I would say, on top of the root systems. But I have a mulch layer already of 2 to 4 inches that there's no absorption to the roots. So there is a way that way itself, because I can tell you it won't penetrate down that far. And if it does, it's very minimal. It's not going to cause damage to a tree that's, you know, this big.
Established.
Yeah, it's just not. That would be my easiest way to tell you. I've done areas, Sturgeon City, we just put in some trees over there. From a maintenance standpoint, we didn't put any mulch around the trees. But that's because that's more of a native park. I wanted to give more of a native feel to it. It works both ways, but I have the manpower to be able to weed eat if I need to and that type of thing. So I've done different things different ways. But from a beautification standpoint, you know, pulling weeds or spraying Roundup, something like that as a contact killer, it's not going to hurt as long as you've got some type of mulch layer there. I wouldn't recommend spraying Roundup right on top of the grass.
I think the key is the barrier.
Yeah, yeah. And what we do when we plant trees, if I'm making it a mulch ring, we actually paint out where our mulch ring is going to be. Then we actually take out, we sod cut that grass area out completely. Then we dig our plant, we plant our plant, and we backfill with regular compost, and then we put mulch on top of it. So we completely eradicate any weeds that is going to be there to begin with. So we're starting fresh. And I would say that if there's one more important thing is to make sure if you're going to plant a tree, keep the stuff off the root ball as much as possible.
Any other questions? No. All right.
My turn.
Yes.
So I want to talk to you real quickly about April 25th. I'm sure you're aware that that is the Advisory Board Appreciation Dinner. I'm sure you've been contacted. If you haven't sent your RSVPs in, please do so. Just a quick reminder, April 25th, 6 p.m. Where? The Youth Center, right across the street. Okay, so we'd love to have you there. If you've not done that yet, please do so, and we'll go from there. Just a couple other things that I'd like to talk to you about is the not necessarily from a clean and green thing, but from a parks and recreation parks department, just throwing a little blurb out for you. The Jacksonville Jamboree is on May 6th this year. If you have the opportunity for you and anyone watching tonight, come on out. It's a great family event with entertainment, music. And it's a totally free event, unless you're going to eat or have a soda that day. That does cost, but the events themselves are free, and just bear that in mind. We'd love to see you out there. And I want to take a minute to talk about what Jason talked about a little bit tonight, which was our clean and green presentation. And I know Jason and I had this conversation this morning, and one of the things, you know, that we'd like to say is from Jason's seat and my seat is what a great job our staff does. We hear that from you and we appreciate that, but our staff needs to hear that even from us, and we try and tell them that. We could never tell them enough the things that we've done, the presentation, you know, we actually showed that to them. We wanted them to see, look what we did, look what you did. And we talked, I know Mr. Shelfbon and I talked earlier, that creates the pride and the ownership for them of, wow, look what we've done. And we could not do any of this without the staff that we have, and kudos to them. The other thing I want to talk about briefly is the amphitheater. If you've not looked at the amphitheater, if you've only heard of it, it is really starting to shape up. And big kudos to Scott Perosi, who is our assistant park superintendent. He is the gentleman that you have seen his work throughout the city. He has done the in front of the depot, the the well, the pond. Mm-hmm. He built that. He's also who built the hardscapes out here with the pavers. He's the gentleman who done the majority of the paver work for the splash pad at Jack Amiette. He's also the gentleman that's leading our staff in what we're doing at the amphitheater in putting the walls up that separate the levels. It's pretty impressive. Jason talked to you about us doing installations and things like that. There's always a major benefit to the city when we use the expertise of our staff, because we can do it, and we can do it a whole lot cheaper than bidding it out and having a contractor come do it. Now, there's times we have to do that for one reason or another, but any time that we have the availability to use the expertise that we have on our staff, we try to do that, and again, trying to be as efficient as possible. Does it create some havoc for us? We've already got a job, and now we're going to take it. Yeah, it does. But in a big picture, from the city's big picture view, it's a cost savings. It's a major cost savings, and we try to always do that. But I wanted to point out the amphitheater to you because the walls are almost finished, and we're going to start putting asphalt walkways in and concrete pads for the stage, and the electricity is going to start being installed, and the lighting and all of those sorts of things. So when you do ride by there and you wonder, what are they doing over there? Mm-hmm. That's what they're doing, and our expectation is by next spring we'll be having events out there, and we'll go from there. But I wanted to at least give you a heads up. And the last thing I want to say is, two quick things is, we could not do the work we do without Jason's vision and his leadership. DOT has been very good to us, and a lot of thanks go to Anthony Prince, who I'm sure you know, and helping us secure funding and creating agreements for us to work with DOT. But Jason does a lot of the designing. Now, we have to work with a landscape architect, but we've gotten to the point where we basically design it, give it to the landscape architect. They make the tweaks that fit into the world of DOT, put their seal on it, and we move forward. So, that's the good thing, and the value that Jason has added to us from the Parks Division or Parks Department into the city. And the other thing is, the Grove, I know, is very near and dear to everybody here. And the good news is, I think you were telling me Monday, what did we see out at the Grove?
We had buds coming on the tree.
So we had buds coming on the tree, which is a great sign. And just pointing out to you to have only lost two trees and one rose bush over the last 24 months, basically. I think the Grove is doing well right now, and will continue to do well for years. But thank you for having us tonight. It's a great opportunity for us to show you the challenges, the opportunities, and the accomplishments that we've been able to do over the last year, and show you that we're trying to be as efficient as possible and be good stewards of your money, the taxpayers' money, and trying to do as much with our money as we possibly can. And thanks for having us here tonight.
Sure. Thank you all. And again, thank y'all for all that you do.
We're doing the new playground equipment at the parks too, aren't you?
We are.
So they're a lot of fun. I can tell you that firsthand. I've crawled in and out of those cylinder tubes.
Well, those are Dr. That is actually Dr. Woodruff's prototype of the ninja course, which you're talking about, Phillips Park. Uh-huh. Yes, yes, absolutely. Which, if you ride by 17 across from Courts Park, that's Phillips Park, you'll see these very bright cylinders out there, and you'll see kids running through them, and it's a great way to use some things that were just sitting around.
Grandparents
made use of them. Yeah, we made use of them, and kids love them.
The next item is the Planning Advisory Board update. A lot of things we've been doing since I last gave you an update, most of it's been amendments to the UDO, which is the Unified Development Ordinance. It's just been text amendments dealing with, like, the setbacks for ATM machines, the wireless telecommunication towers, just some verbiage in those. There is one new development approval, and that's Paul Dice. I'm not sure if y'all are familiar with that. It's a pet boarding grooming facility over on Center Street. And right now, they've been using like 3,000, I think it's roughly 3,000 square feet, and they are doing an addition to that, a little over 3,000, so they'll have slightly over 6,000 square feet once it's all said and done. So that is all I have for the planning board. Our next meeting is Thursday, June 1st. Again, anybody that wants to, if you'll just sign this, if you do want to go, Glenn will have that. And I think that is about it. Is there anybody that has any questions, comments, anything that you'd like to share?
I got one thing. This week you're going to see an article in the newspaper concerning the Bayshore Estates. The Daltman over here, they have the city started with the livable neighborhood started up the area. And they're having a major dispute going on right now with the Postal Department over the mailboxes. Recently, their post office told them they had to put mailboxes up on the street if the tenants moved or somebody moved out. And I guess over the long run, basically a lot of us were forced to put mailboxes out there and told we had to take the mailbox off the houses and this and that. And the people who live in the neighborhood didn't want the mailboxes off their homes because it's the oldest neighborhood in Jacksonville and they wanted to keep the old-looking houses. Mm-hmm. And so it got down to where they invited the postmaster over. He told them they had to move the mailbox to the street. Somebody got to the paper. The paper got to Washington, D.C., Postal Department. The Postal Department said there's no such regulation. You've been lied to. So now the newspaper writing a big article was a big stink. So they wanted to be brought to you guys because it's part of the parents of Jacksonville. And a lot of neighbors that are older have kept their oldness and their mystique of themselves, and they wanted to keep theirs, and they feel as if they're being singled up. And so it's even gone to the part where the postal carrier has come to you and said, I will pay for the mailbox, put it in, I'll put it in my time. And you didn't have a right to do that. That's conflict of interest. So there's going to be a big article in the paper, so watch for this week.
Right.
The city knows about it. The city manager's aware of it.
Well, thanks for the heads up.
So be looking for it in the paper.
Mm-hmm. Anybody else have anything to share? Nope. Mm-hmm. All right. Do we have a motion to adjourn?
A motion.
I second you.
All in favor?
All right.
Thank you all. Have a good night.